have one question for you.
Yeah.
Why are there people like Frank?
Why does this world have to be so hard?
We all have an appearance, but beneath that, there's so many strange things happening.
What was the first time you saw it? Remember?
It was in 1986 at the theater, and it.
And what are those again?
They're buildings where.
That's not important right now.
This woman has to be gotten to a hospital.
A hospital? What is it?
It's a big building with patients, but that's not important right now.
No, I think this is where I may have a unique perspective, because in the 1800s, when I was a child, I saw this at the theater, and it really left such an impression on me that I've carried it through with me and been influenced by it. In a way that's just sort of impressionable, and I can't really, you know, I've done things in some of my own creative projects and thought, wow, that's pretty cool. And then later I realized, oh shit, I kind of stole that from Blue Velvet.
So it made a huge impression on you. Is what you're saying, right away.
Yes, right away.
Well, let me ask you, because you mentioned about seeing it in the theaters, I have to ask, do you remember what the audience reaction was like? Were they just kind of just stunned, or they just kind of wash it over and were like, ooh, I got to think about this one for a minute.
I don't remember other people's reaction, but I do remember mine about several things in the movie. But I was, at the end of it, kind of like, okay, things have just changed, or they're changing. Mm. Because it is that psychological horror. And I think, you know, when we're talking about me coming here and we're thinking about, well, what horror things could we talk about? And I thought, well, that's... It's so close to a what's called a horror movie, because we could take Frank Booth and put fangs on him or make him a werewolf, boom, instant horror movie. But it's that psychological horror that, and for me, that's the difference between horror that you would see in sort of an 80s horror movie.
Yeah, like a slasher.
A slasher kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is...
It's almost like the beginning of the transition into 90s erotic thrillers.
Yeah.
Like getting away from slashers and 80s horror into more of a kind of psychological eroticism. And also all the late night, you know, scrambled TVs that, you know, us little kids were... trying to see a boobie.
Yeah.
You know? Oh, there's a nipple.
But Blue Velvet kind of is like early on in that kind of Basic Instinct, kind of thriller, but, you know, with, of course, David Lynch's
I just have to go back to that gritty, dirty feel, though.
Yeah.
Because it is, while there's Basic Instinct is, it's sort of like a polished version.
Yeah, Basic Instinct to me is a super clean, brand new hardback, mass market hardback that just came out in the New York Times bestseller. And Blue Velvet is this one of a kind, used, grungy, scary book in the back of a used bookstore that nobody's seen.
Yeah, that's missing a page here and there.
Yeah,
like, well, what the fuck is going? I don't.
Yeah. But I love it.
I love it, and I'll, and that's what's great about it, is where Basic Instinct ties up all the loose ends for you, and it's great. I mean, it's fantastic.
I love it. Perfect. I love it.
But what I really love about Blue Velvet and David Lynch in general is there are torn out pages in his stories, and he's allowing you to fill those in. And so when you talk to a story with somebody else about, oh, I like the part where they did this, and then I go, oh, wait, what?
Yeah.
You know, because you filled that part of the story in a different way.
Right. It's a true painting of a movie.
It's a painting of a movie.
You get three people looking at it, and they go, well, what about Frank's part? You're like, oh, I didn't think about that. I didn't consider this part, you know?
It is absolutely a paint. It's,
can I ask you?
Hold on, I think I have a movie quote. It would be... Watching this film is like looking at a painting in 24 frames a second.
All right, that's it. All right, we're good. Jason, thank you for coming by. I just want to thank you. Yeah. No. I mean, it really, and I'll say this from the beginning. This is the first David Lynch movie I've ever seen in my life. And I would recommend this one to be the first that anyone sees, because technically it is the most straightforward besides his movie, The Straight Story, which is wonderful.
Yeah.
But this movie to me is, there's definitely a lot of mystery, a lot of what's under the weeds here, a lot to take in. But I think it's the most straightforward and the most accessible for someone who's never heard of David Lynch. Like, hey, you know what? Slide this one.
If you're interested in David Lynch, this has all of his DNA in it.
Yes.
Absolutely. You know? Yes, it does. Eraserhead and Elephant Man have this gloomy feel. And that, and you know, a lot of that I know has to do with that black and white, dark and deep.
Flickering.
A lot of deep shadows.
Deep
like inky,
shadows.
Inky black.
Yeah. And Blue Velvet is it's in color, in very rich, beautiful color.
It's beautiful.
But
nobody gets blacks.
There's so many.
No. Nobody gets blacks.
No,
like
nobody
David
gets blacks.
Lynch.
But a lot of those shots are so, they echo film noir movies so much. There's a lot of shots you can go, just turn that black and white, and I think I'm watching a music.
For sure.
You can't overstate how important the blacks are, especially to the point where on his, I don't know if it's on the DVD, but on the Blu-ray of all, every one of his Blu-rays comes with a color chart to adjust your television.
Really?
I love that.
Every single shot, especially within a scene, they got to live. You cut from this shot to this shot and they're not matched. Bang, you're out of the film. Just for that, it'll just break something. It's got to hold in a certain way, especially scene by scene, so it doesn't break. And it's tricky business. And there are some great timers in the world that help you get that thing, you know, feeling correct. Then when it goes to DVD, you got to go into the telecine bay again, because what you did in film doesn't translate to what you do in high def.
Apparently he was very much like that with theatrical premieres with sound too. He was like, set your audio to this, mm-hmm. you know, all these like notes, like really detailed things.
And you would think after like, even after I've read tons of books about him and stuff, he seems like the least technologically inclined person. Like he's not interested in the technical aspects, but on a story level, he knows how important they are.
Yeah.
And so he does the research and does the, you know, he's all about, I've heard him talk several times about trying to get cameras smaller and lighting done faster so that he can produce more scenes and be more creative. But it's always for that creativeness.
The camera would be real little, and you could do, you know, you could rehearse the moves, you know, and it would just be a different, that's what it could be, right? That's one step. Like Coppola says, you could just think, you know, your film onto the screen and it would appear there. That's what he wants to do.
But yeah, we were talking about Lynch cutting his teeth with Eraserhead, and even though he's not maybe the most technical guy, mm-hmm. I think it kind of benefits him, you know, where he can just go with pure instinct.
I believe so. He's held on to that, and the thing that he's kept through those early films up into Blue Velvet was, as he still carries it, is his tone. And so I think it's, while that technically he may, you know, he's getting other people to do that who know more than he does about the technical aspect, but he absolutely brings his tone into that and says, you're coming with this sort of mysticism or whatever it is, whatever word you would...
And his instincts.
Yeah,
his instincts.
He truly is, and I don't like to throw this word out too much, I do think he's a true auteur. Like, you know, like there is no comparison to... You could say some modern people are trying to take what he is doing, you know, and not in a bad way. We all take, and you should take. But there is no other David Lynch.
He's also an excellent collaborator.
Oh, of course.
Yeah. And
especially the actors, I'm told.
Yeah.
Like, from what
and the,
I hear.
And the crew. Like the piece of trivia, there's a props guy who was tasked by David Lynch to find something to use as the microphone for Dean Stockwell.
Oh.
And he went around looking. It was night, and he was kind of, like, pissed about it. And he was, like, looking around the truck, and he found a couple things like handheld and, you know, a hairbrush, and was like, ah, fucking, what does David Lynch want me to find, you know? And he had caught himself in the mirror, and his work light that he was using to look was like uplighting him.
Wonderful.
And he was just so cool. He was just like,
I love it.
I've got it.
And he literally light bulb.
But the greatest moment was he gave it to David, and David's like,
so cool.
David lit up and like was a kid on set until they shot it, and while they were shooting it, he was like a child, like jumping for joy.
So
that
cool.
It was the coolest thing ever.
Yeah.
And David Lynch didn't have anything to do with that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But that's like now a trademark. It's just so effective.
He knows when he sees gold, he's like, we got something.
Yeah, and he knows that it's magic. And mm-hmm. like when other people bring that to him, that's shared magic.
Yeah, that like was totally magical when I saw it in the theater too. That was the
because it's almost like a segue, but just kind of like it just all of a sudden we're living in this moment.
I close my eyes, then I drift away into the magic night. I softly say,
and there's like. You could one would argue, like, what's the point of this scene? It's like, well, maybe there is no point. Maybe we're just on the ride, and we're just going to wait and see what happens, you know?
There's one more piece of trivia.
It does build tension, though, too.
There's one more piece of trivia, and that's all the trivia I have, so I want to, like, get rid of it. Okay. But the ear, which is the next major prop in this movie, like, can't be overstated. The ear...
I heard about... I think I know what you're going to say.
Maybe, they don't know for sure, but maybe the first actual use of silicone in special effects.
Isn't that crazy?
In the film.
Yeah.
And the guy was just experimenting with it, just like anything else, like different processes and stuff, and silicone worked the best.
And I read that apparently the first couple were like so tiny that they're like kids' ears. And
he was like, they weren't...
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
David Lynch thought they were kids' ears. but it was the makeup effects artist's ear, and he was like,
he was like,
check this out, David, and he was like, yeah, it's pretty good, just make it bigger, and he's like, okay, and he's like, yeah, they can't be the like kids' ears, they gotta be adults' ears, and he's like, well, it's my ear, and he like, well, he's like, okay, well, make it bigger.
I want to say something about
please the
ears, and specifically children's. Ears.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Because.
Oh God, what are you gonna bring out?
I just thought, because.
Is that where all these ants are coming from? Yeah.
Everybody.
Oh, no! Yes. Yes.
So, and these are about the size of children's ears.
Oh my God! You can stick your finger all the way in it.
And what I've found is if I put my finger in it, I tend to want to do this after.
Yeah, let me investigate it.
Not me.
Yeah. That's like, great. Nope, that's crass.
That's great.
The ear was, what a great...
Can we reenact the Reservoir Dogs scene after this?
Sure.
Yeah. Hello? Yeah. You hear that?
You know...
this is awesome.
Frank Booth has a couple of funny lines, actually.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, he's got a lot of...
As gross as a human he is in that movie, he does have very comical
iconic
moments.
Yeah. Yes.
There's one that he does just under his breath, kind of just a throwaway, when he's in Valerie's apartment, and this is after he's, you know, knocked her around and hit her a couple
of
times.
Dorothy,
I'm sorry. What did I say?
He said Valerie. Who's Valerie?
Dorothy Valens. Valens? Dorothy Valens?
Oh, that's it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I was never wrong.
Cut that. Ray Liotta, thanks for joining us.
So,
I'm all ears.
He says, stay alive, baby. Do it for Van Gogh. And it's just kind of a throwaway line. Do it for Van Gogh. And we don't know that at this point, I don't think.
Yeah, no.
It's like just referring to her husband, of course. But and he has one other one.
I mean, everything he says is iconic.
Oh, yeah.
And it's the way he says it, you know?
Let's fuck!
Yeah.
I'll fuck anything that moves!
When you bring up Heineken, like that alone, He's just so like filled with venom when he hears
Heineken. Fuck that shit. Pabst Blue Ribbon. Let's hit the fucking road.
And when we talked about this, we were like, okay, that's the one thing we actually agree with on Frank Booth. It's like, fuck Heineken. Fuck Heineken.
It's great because they set up with you know, Kyle MacLachlan's like, oh, I love Heineken.
Man, I like Heineken. You like Heineken?
Well, I never really had Heineken before.
You never had Heineken before?
Yeah, he tries it out with Sandy, you know, at the bar.
Such a great callback, yeah.
And then, like, he gets shit on for liking
it.
That's
great.
So good.
What kind of beer do you like? Heineken. Heineken? Fuck that shit! Pabst Blue Ribbon!
And those are the beer that they choose as their personality. So he's got Heineken. So, he's a little, you know, he's been off to college for a year. He knows a little more. He's
a little more global.
He
drinks beer.
Still drinks beer. Yes. But he's like Frank, but he's a more polished version of Frank. And then Frank, of course, is
he knows what he is.
Blue, has. There are less things in his brain to think about. He's got about five things to choose
and
from.
Is and that's everywhere.
And then, and their cars also. I kind of like the beers that match personalities. You know, he's got his.
Great cars. I didn't even think about that. Jeffrey's car is like it's. A little nicer.
David Lynch's cars are always awesome. A lot of good art.
Which, by the way, this is something I didn't really notice until like years went on after I've seen this movie. And I love the kind of, because you ever see a picture of Lynch like in his art school days and like even Eraserhead? He dresses very similar to Kyle MacLachlan in this movie.
And Kyle MacLachlan is almost like a stand-in for him when his
Yeah, and it's funny too, because he brings up, he goes the first, because you know, Lynch is a very prominent guy as far as like, I have ideas, I don't have like, you know, stories, I have ideas, you know, and which is very interesting. And he was like, the first idea I had for this movie was someone who wants to see a woman naked in a closet and he's hiding, he's trying to be quiet, and then someone bad comes in. That's all he had. Mm-hmm. And then the second thing was ear in the grass with ants. Yeah. And I was like, I love how
not
little
just
pictures.
The ear, but like he wanted the right person to find the ear, because that would lead to new experiences he's never had before.
That's right.
So and that this go ahead.
Like a gameplay.
Exactly.
The film to me is about a couple of things, speaking of ideas, which is, I've talked about this before, about in life, you curves and angles. And for the most part, in our lives, we're on kind of a gradual curve. We sort of know where we're going. We know what we want to do, but some things happen along the way that you don't really know. You know, you can't predict the future, but something happens and you go with it. But then we all have these angles in life where something happens and from that moment on it changes. Well, in the movie, when Kyle MacLachlan finds the ear, that's his angle. If it weren't for the ear, that's what on his path completely changes everything. And that's the reason we have the story.
Yep.
And a little bit of that in the opening scene where his father has the stroke and falls down. In fact, they tell the entire story in that opening scene.
Microcosm
of the entire
story.
And
micro-imagery, too.
And micro-imagery.
Such a great opening.
And it said the way that he looks, that David Lynch looks in real life and Kyle MacLachlan, and that is also, to me, that's what the film is about, is one, the sort of curves and angles. The other thing is, the more obvious point is, the dark side and the good and the bad of everyone, and how nothing is as it seems on the surface. Just as David Lynch looks like this little nerdy dorky guy, he's actually thinking about murder right now, you know, or Kyle MacLachlan is, you know, personifying that in that
he seems innocent.
He seems completely innocent, like the little nerd, but what he really wants to do, he wants to go to the most dangerous place he could possibly go.
He actually wants to tap in a little bit to Frank.
A little bit naivete, but a little bit of courage and a little bit of curiosity.
Yeah.
A lot of curiosity.
A lot of curiosity.
Especially when the affair begins between Kyle MacLachlan and Isabella Rossellini, like there's that, when she wants to be hit, you know, mm-hmm. and he like is resistant to it, yeah. but he also kind of wants to try it because yeah. he knows that mm-hmm. Frank has complete possession over her yeah. because he's so violent.
And the world is always completely foreign to him at every stage. Like anytime he's presented with a new challenge like that, it's so new to him and so foreign that he has to rewrite his brain right. at each yeah. intersection. And it's happening so frequently within a matter of days that he's having to reevaluate his whole perspective.
Yeah. And I don't think it's a coincidence that his character is a college student. You know what I mean? He's experiencing these mm-hmm. new things. Like you right. said, you mentioned the yeah. Heineken thing. Like this is, it's not a coincidence.
It's almost like a final coming of age, not just maturity, but like a...
coming to grips, you know, with things, you know?
Yeah.
I think if he's coming to grips with something and as an underlying theme, it is, I feel that Lynch is saying, we all have the, I mean, call it what you will, the sure. darkness yeah, inside of us. And what yeah. you have to, and to me, you know, the blue velvet when Frank Booth is putting it in his mouth and then he puts it in somebody else's mouth. He's always putting it into somebody's that's good.
Yes.
And he's, you know, bad or evil or the dark side. Yeah. And he is connecting evil with
like
good.
An umbilical cord.
And that's sort of, yes, yeah. it
that's
is
a
like
great
an
way
umbilical
of putting
cord.
It.
Yeah. yeah. And yeah. it's that you have to somehow in life find a way to live with your own bad and not push yes. it away, but welcome it. But you have to learn how to have, you know, one boot in both sides
yeah.
and let them coexist instead of saying, well, that's just not like that.
Like a yin yang.
Exactly.
A yin yeah. yin yang.
And they are the yin and yang, you know, Tom McLaughlin yeah, and Hopper. Yeah. Like, again, like him being in the closet looking through these like violent yes. images, it's like that voyeuristic thing. You know, it's yeah. like yeah. literally like just right from the textbook of yeah. him just being like, okay, I want to peer into this. I yeah. don't want to be Frank, yeah. but I want to tap into what is going on here.
They both want love, and like Frank's so complex with his like love addiction. You see him like in the club when he's like holding the blue velvet and yeah. crying, listening to her.
Through my tears,
he just wants what everybody wants, but he's so tormented and off the deep end, essentially forcing his way through life, forcing other people to do things, and being a force of nature to be reckoned with. And really, like you said, if there's a yin and yang in everyone, his is unbalanced all the way evil.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And that he will not reckon with that. He is just that incarnate. And so yeah. you now have to deal with him, Jeffrey, because you are so curious to get into this world. You now have to deal with Frank Booth. And
that's
you
right.
have to deal with everybody
but
around
Frank.
Frank
also,
Booth.
You know, he could have done a lot of bad things to Jeffrey. He could have
yeah.
he could have tortured him as right. he did these other people. But I think he sees himself in Jeffrey. Right. Jeffrey is the young, you know,
curious.
he's yeah, obviously he's not going to go all the way to Frank Booth land, but he I think Frank sees in him that, oh,
yes.
there's a darkness inside
yeah.
this some kid.
Weird. Yeah.
And I think that plays off his, not just his demeanor and like the voyeuristic stuff, but also his costume. You know, he's wearing black. You
yeah.
know, it's like this guy is alternative, you know?
Yeah.
He's different, literally.
yeah. yeah. But his downfall ultimately comes down to his underestimating of Jeffrey
yeah.
and thinking he's just a little shit.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And
a pushover.
So, yeah. And so he eventually loses his grip on the whole situation because, you know, at every turn he thinks he has Jeffrey under his thumb.
Yeah.
Too.
Yeah.
And luckily for Jeffrey, he's so pure.
Yeah.
You know, he's a baby.
Yeah.
Just
yeah.
like Sandy. He's like the male version of Sandy, just
yeah.
a little more curious. That his purity wins out and he's able to think of ways to counteract everything that Frank goes left, he judes right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's able to manipulate the situation because they're so polar.
Yeah,
you
and
know,
you were saying the naivete is a good way
it's
to make,
great.
Oh, just make him
yeah.
a college
yeah.
kid so he's still,
yeah.
you know, he's dumb, he's He's smart enough to know some stuff, but he's still dumb enough
to
know.
He has no world.
Yeah.
Who has the balls to, like, get a fucking exterminator backpack and go in someone's apartment?
Yeah, come on, like within, like, 5 minutes of finding the ear, he's like, I know what I'm going to do.
Stumbling right, yeah. into each thing, and then before you know it, he's in her closet. Yeah. But he's watching her undress.
I think you nailed it, though. It's like, you can read so much about the world, but you don't know the world until you experience it, right? So it's like you can read about the horrific things in the world, but that you don't know it until you actually experience it.
He's pulled out of that closet of naivete, of curiosity, and he's forced to experience what he was curious in.
Yeah. Isabella Rossellini, though, you know, everybody talks about Hopper. No, everybody should be talking about her.
She's great.
She's incredible. Yeah.
And that was one of her first acting. Yeah.
Unbelievable.
When
I saw, when I went to the theater, I knew that she was a model and that she was Ingrid Bergman's daughter. That's all I knew. And then to see her on screen, I mean, she changed what I wanted in what I thought was attractive in a woman. She was older.
That maturity.
She was the maturity. Yeah. She's a little bit crazy.
It's okay. Yeah. We all like crazy. Just a little, just a dash.
In 1986, there was, when you saw a naked female body in movies, there was one kind of body that you saw.
Yeah.
And it looked like what you would see like in an 80s music video or something. Yeah. And she didn't have a body like that.
Right.
And it was, I don't know, that made her all the more attractive.
Yeah, because she's real.
Yeah, she's real.
And just the fact that she would do that and show I don't know. Uh-huh. It blew my mind.
It's brave, you know? Yeah.
Very
it really
brave.
Is.
Yeah.
I always thought it was interesting because you always see the cover with, or some posters with, kind of doing that tango on the floor,
which made me avoid this movie for so long. Like I'm being, because I was, you know, I was 14, 13. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was
think
like,
it's a love.
I was like, I'm not gonna see some fucking romance. Like, what the fuck is this?
And I think at that point he's nude. She might be in velvet. They might be nude together. But I remember, you know how kind of like, naked. I don't know who said this or what it really even means, but like sex is like the great equalizer. And the way what I was thinking of with that thought process is, you see them in a casting audition next to each other. They don't look like they'd ever be interested in like making a couple or a unit that would look like society would want them to look.
Yeah.
But when they're nude together and they're making love, they look perfect.
You're right.
It's unreal. Like when they're in each other's embrace, it's like you couldn't find two pearls that matched better.
I agree. You know,
absolutely.
It's
right.
Unreal. Yeah. The artistry of the sex scenes, the artistry of
and there's
intimacy.
An age difference. I don't know what it is.
Yeah, but
you're
beautiful.
Right.
It's incredible.
It looks like they are made. That's a great point.
Yeah, it's insane.
Well, Hopper had. Jump back to Hopper because I just...
Hey,
come on.
There's a lot to talk about with Dennis Hopper in this movie.
There is. But I'm trying to think before, like what movies he was... He was kind of inactive for a long time.
After like the Easy Rider ride, I mean,
He dabbled in directing. He did a great film called Out of the Blue.
Like the last
incredible
movie.
The last movie, that's okay.
Nobody wanted to work with him.
He was kind of blacklisted. And like his drug problem was pretty severe.
Yeah. Yes.
And made all his interactions turbulent. Mm-hmm.
But
Lynch was like thrilled to have him.
Yeah, good. Know? Because, I mean, there's an energy that he can, it's almost like he has to act in real life like he's normal.
Well,
and then when the camera turns on. Oh, he did?
Yeah. He told David Lynch, he's like, I'm Frank Booth.
He's like, you have to hire me because I am
Frank Booth.
Yeah. He's got, there's a wildness in him that translates past the screen that you feel, and you feel like, God, if I was in the room with that.
Yeah, it's intense.
That's
intense with a TV in between you.
Yeah.
You can imagine what it'd be.
Oh, yeah.
On set. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Can you imagine all the outtakes?
So speaking of
baby, what the fuck? Fucking Freudian slips like all day long.
All day long.
So let's talk about that for a second. So you heard that originally the device that he's using, you know, apparently Lynch wanted to be helium.
Yeah, which is
so
hilarious.
So his voice is like, squeaky clean!
Yeah. Yeah.
Which kind of sounds incredible. Like, it kind of sounds
I kind of want to see an alternate version of
what that sounds incredible.
That sounds terrifying.
Yeah. Baby, what the fuck?
Yeah, like that sounds terrifying.
It does sound terrifying.
And he kind of did it a little bit.
A little bit. But I appreciate what the alternative was. Yeah. Apparently, that
just
was
nitrous.
Apparently, Hopper was like, you know what? Like, back in the day, like in my day, like, when we really want to get fucked up, we do something like this, you know? And I was like, okay.
Yeah, nitrous oxide.
And I think Lynch respect that. He was like, okay, this is a frequent drug user.
Yeah.
I'm going to take his road. I'm going to go on that road as opposed to my weird helium dream. But I would like to see an alternate version of him with that.
Sounds like a... Yeah.
Sounds creepy as shit. Yeah.
Yeah, especially... It's such a cool fucking device.
Oh, so cool. It just so...
Because no one does it. Yeah, nobody does it. You don't go to a party and see somebody fucking on
nitrous. Although Hopper said it was a normal thing.
Yeah.
Parties in the 70s, you go there and there's the tank.
Yeah, but... I speak for myself. Never seen anyone at a party doing nitrous.
Yeah.
But you can
see
him.
This guy doesn't know how to party.
Yeah, exactly.
What? Loser.
I'm Jeffrey. Hopper is Frank.
Hey, hear me now?
I'm Jeffrey.
Hear me now?
As much as I want to say I fuck anything that moves... I am more Jeffrey, and I'm looking behind the curtains and everything. But yeah, I think that the prop of the nitrous oxide tank
is
so good, because I don't ever recall seeing a tank, but I know there is one.
There is. It's but I think you only
it's always
see
kind
it
of behind.
When
him
he turns it up at one point. And that's about it. Yeah.
And he huffs it, and you already are scared of Frank.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then that's like that line in Fear and Loathing where it's like you can turn your back on a person but you can't turn your back on a drug. Mm. And it's like you know that it's a temporary drug because he has to keep doing it.
Yeah.
So it's like whippets almost.
Yes. Yeah.
And so you're just like he just got a hit and then it's just like for the next 25 seconds you're going to get some
because
real
you're
shit.
Already terrified of him.
Yes.
And now he's doing what the fuck?
Now
is
he's on nitrous.
Yeah.
You're putting a match in gasoline. Like all right, let's see what happens.
Yeah.
And then he does it again.
And then he
shoves the fucking blue velvet in his mouth. Everything is kind of mouth related with him.
Yeah.
It's really interesting.
You said something about when he was at the slow club and it shows him with the piece of velvet and he's crying and stuff. And I think that was really important for Lynch to show us that a guy who's at 10 of scary and brutal and terrorizing.
It's a soft.
Yeah, because if you show him, which goes back into the psychological horror, because that's horror that we all have a natural fear that saves us from things like, I'm afraid of this. Psychological horror is we're scared of something because of, it's like a learned horror.
Yeah.
You know, it's based on things that are bad that have happened to us. Mm-hmm. So when they show him crying, Frank
vulnerable.
Booth, of all people, crying, that lets us know that he's not a vampire, he's not a werewolf.
No.
He's actually
he's
just like us, which makes him way fucking scarier.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It basically like we're gonna establish a new range of human emotion.
Yeah.
You know, we're gonna see somebody go from we're gonna redefine where zero is and where 10 is, and then we're gonna make him go to 11.
Baby wants to fuck. Get ready to fuck! You fuckers, fucker! You fucker!
Yes.
And real quick, we gotta talk about this for a second. It can be very brief, but his ragtag group of friends. Dean Stockwell, Brad Dourif.
Oh man,
Brad Dourif.
Brad Dourif is incredible in it. Incredible.
That's the best group of dudes I'd want around me to do some vile shit with.
They're still afraid of him though.
They all act like
such a little.
That's a good touch because you need a villain who's scarier than the minions.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's why he's on top.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dean Stockwell's delicious.
Dude.
Oh, yeah.
My
he's
so
God. I want to hang out with that
what
dude.
What is his name in the his character?
Fuck.
Well,
no, keep talking.
I love his house
up,
with the
up.
Women and just like kind of, you know, he's like a drug dealer and they're all just kind of like...
And he's So he's obviously
it's like something simple like Bud
in the underworld because he's the one keeping
he was just basing or something.
What is it?
Ben is his
Ben.
Name.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. You could tell they had like a little opium den going on maybe in one of the side rooms and then some black market shit going on.
Yeah.
So cool.
Or underworld shit going on with the kidnapping and
the old
stuff.
The older ladies that are.
Anyone want to go on a joyride with us? How about you? Huh?
There, older ladies, and like so this rockabilly grimy. Kind of vibe that's like not quite rockabilly, but not quite.
I have to tell you, that was so impressionable. I sought that kind of world out, not knowing if it truly existed or was this on film.
It's like a painting.
Of course it turns, it really exists. You know, I've never met a Frank Booth or anything, but I've been in some fucking shady places and I'm like,
It sucks whenever you get stuck at those.
Yes.
You're like, oh no, everyone else is fucked up and I'm stuck here. There's no,
no way out of here.
Yeah. I'm sure we've all been, like when I think of Frank Booth, I think of, and obviously I'm not comparing the two, but like, I have been there in high school knocking on a trailer park door at 3 a.m. looking for a 20 sack of weed and being like, what am I going to get into? What is this guy on the other door going to do to me? What do I have to sit through? What do I have to listen to for 30
and
minutes?
And they always want to hang out.
Yeah.
They don't just want to have a transaction.
I'm like, okay, thank you. And instead he's like, okay, so anyways, you know, the pyramids are built by the aliens.
You're like, I don't need a seat.
You're doing the slow right. Okay, well,
so anyways, I gotta
you want to watch Jennifer's body?
You're like, what?
Do you want to watch Dark Side with Wizard of Oz? We'll sync him up.
You want us Return to Oz?
Yeah. God, I got Face of Death Volume 3 here. Let's watch
It's already playing. It's already playing.
Yeah, no, we've been there. So, like, when I see that stuff, I think of Frank Booth and his buddies with the fucking creepy ass den they're in.
Yeah, know? My favorite moment, I think, in the whole movie, though, that is not like on the level, that's just kind of its own little thing, is the moment that woman jumps up on the car and starts dancing.
Love
it.
I close my eyes.
Don't be a good neighbor to her. I'll send you a love letter.
Straight from my heart, fucker!
In the middle of a very intense scene, it shows that range that you talked about, like, let's establish the insanity of this moment and like show somebody completely who hasn't said a word.
Nope.
And has gone along with everything so far, is probably high.
Yeah.
You know, or at least something. And she's just in her own bubble.
Yep.
And that's how she gets off. And it's fucking cool. If a woman did that, I'd be like, fuck
You
know. And she just casually crawls up on
crawls
top
of the, top of the car and just starts dancing. And it's not sexy. It's not cool.
Meanwhile, they're beating up on poor Jeffrey.
Well,
and so she's
and that leads into that
another mouth thing, too.
Oh,
he's
I was going to say, the lipstick. Yeah. So that part really, when I the first time I ever saw that, that made me like go, oh, fuck. Not because it's a dude kissing another dude, but the way he was doing it is very forceful, and very messy.
I'm not sure if it's Roy Orbison, but those Candyman lyrics.
Roy Orbison,
Oh my God, it's just the perfect lyrics. They're perfect, script to say
and
to someone.
Now, this may just be me, but the, I was just touching the ear, and it has to do with the ear.
I've been touching this ear the whole time.
When Frank Booth starts saying those words as they're playing, he's saying them directly in directly to Jeffrey.
Absolutely.
And I don't know the lyrics exactly, but there's something like, in dreams, I walk with you.
Yeah.
In dreams, I talk to you.
Yeah.
And so I feel like throughout this whole movie, there's tons of dream talk. There's to where at the very end, and in the beginning, you know, we travel into the ear, which leads to the mind.
Right.
At the very end of the movie, we come out of Jeffrey's ear, and it's and so you have to think at least for a moment.
Frank
wait, was this whole fucking thing a dream? And Frank is the dark part. Frank doesn't even exist, and he's the dark part of Jeffrey. And Jeffrey's been sleeping this whole time, and he's thought he's been having a nightmare, because Frank Booth is telling him right there that I'm in dreams. This is a dream. He's almost telling the audience, this is a dream. Now, I think that's Lynch saying, this can be a dream if you want it to be.
Absolutely.
But
But I prefer, we're going for reality.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
what that's what makes all these things more visceral.
Absolutely.
This is real. Yeah.
And, but yeah. I think you're right, though, with him singing the lyrics to him, it's almost like he's telling him, like, we're not so far off, you and I. Yeah. Also.
I also, you know, what I got from that was, you will never escape me. Yes. Now that you know I exist, you'll never
even if I'm long
be
gone.
Able to be,
yeah.
get rid of
I'm
me.
In your psyche.
Yeah. This, now with you forever.
Yeah, the same way that when
I'm tattooing your brain right now.
He tattooed all of our brains.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
But in the same way that he, abused Dorothy, and so don't you fucking look at me.
Yeah.
And then
physical
so
and
when he goes away, yeah. then okay, now she, what does Dorothy say to Jeffrey? Don't you look at me. Don't look at me.
Yeah.
Hit me. And so it's like it's that same thing of like
he's
I'm in you.
Yeah.
I'm it's too late
it.
Now.
Yeah, I'm changing you.
Yeah, take with it what you want, but it's probably
and that's
not gonna
his
feel
power.
Good.
And that's his, like, you know, he's on the top of the hill right there with all his buddies and he's asserting, you know, dominance and showing his masculinity, and that's him being like, that's, you know, Lynch, anyone could have stopped there, but Lynch is like, we're gonna go into the mind and he's gonna psychologically
absolutely.
Dominate him.
Yes.
And it's like that's so
scary
shit.
Yeah. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming,
here,
Jason.
Dude. Woo! Jason Waller, everybody.
Let's fuck!
Let's fuck!
I'll fuck anything!